गुरुरेव गतिः गुरुमेव भजे गुरुणैव सहास्मिनमो गुरवे न गुरोः परमं शिशुरस्मि गुरोर्मतिरस्ति गुरौ मम पाहि गुरो राम राम राम. सो वी हैव बीन डूइंग रघुवंशम फॉर द पास्ट फोर क्लासेस. सो होपफुली टुडे विल बी द लास्ट क्लास ऑफ रघुवंशम. सो अगेन विल स्टार्ट इमीडिएटली. सो वी हैड लेफ्ट रघुवंशम आफ्टर द 13th सर्ग. त्रयोदश सर्ग वी हैड कंप्लीटेड. And we are to start the 14th sarga. So till now we have seen that Rama has defeated Ravana and he has taken back Sita and they have reached Ayodhya. So this is the state wherein we are in. So the 14th sarga, Chaturdasha sarga, starts with this. So now, as discussed in the end of Trayodasha sarga, Rama, Lakshmana, Sita, Bharata. So these four people are coming in Pushpaka Vimana, whereas the other Vanaras and the bears who were in the army of Rama, they have taken the forms of human beings and they have come on elephants. So first Rama reaches the outskirts of Ayodhya. So now after reaching there he meets for the first time after the 14 long years of exile, for the first time Rama and Lakshmana meet Kausalya and Sumitra. So they are waiting eagerly along with Shatrughna. So what is happening here is, first of all, the mothers Kausalya and Sumitra are old. Secondly, they are filled with the tears of joy that their sons have come back. So because of this, their sight is blurred, so they can't see clearly. So because of this, what is happening is, those mothers, Kausalya and Sumitra, are unable to identify, because they're not able to see them clearly, they're unable to identify who is Rama, who is Lakshmana, and who is Bharata. Because Bharata also has been outside Ayodhya for this long time. So none of those three sons, except for Shatrughna, they have seen. So after 14 years, for the first time when they see, their eyes are blurred because of the tears that are accumulated. And also they're old. So they're unable to identify who is who, but Kalidasa beautifully tells that just by touching and by embracing those sons, they were able to identify who is Rama, who is Lakshmana, and who is Bharata. So finally, Sita comes and salutes. So each of them, all the three sons come and salute Kausalya as well as Sumitra. Then finally, Sita comes and salutes both of them. And again, she tells, sorry, mothers, that I was the cause that your sons, Lakshmana and Bharata, as well as Rama, had to go on exile. But they tell you it's not your mistake. So they console her. Finally, Kalidasa tells that, at this point of time, when Rama comes to salute Kausalya as well as Sumitra, so what happens is, the tears that have accumulated in the eyes of Kausalya and Sumitra, they fall on the head of Rama. Kalidasa beautifully takes this situation and tells it, whenever you perform Rajabhisheka, whenever you do the coronation act, waters from Sapta Sagaras as well as Sapta Nadis, that is seven Punya Nadis, they're brought and they're poured on the head of the king who is being coronated. Kalidasa beautifully tells that the tears that fell from the eyes of Kausalya and Sumitra were the first drops of water that were poured on the head of Rama as a sign of coronation. And this coronation continued after all the seven, the waters from the seven Samudras were poured and the coronation was completed. So the coronation began once the tears of Kausalya and Sumitra fell on the head of Rama. So he's, after all this, process is done, they, give him the royal garments and the ornaments, he wears them and then he enters into Ayodhya. And this is how Rajabhisheka is performed. Then, of course, he's sitting in the chariot. So after all this time, so once he's coronated as a king, he's placed in this royal chariot. And there, Lakshmana as well as Shatrughna, they are doing the Chamara Seva to Rama. And what is Bharata doing? He's holding the Chamara, so the Chatra. So the Chamara is being fanned by Lakshmana and Shatrughna, whereas Bharata is holding the Chatra, the umbrella for Rama. And finally, Sita, who is dressed in the royal garments as well, she is made to sit in a separate queen's chariot. And her glow is very bright. And she is as though she is like the other fire. So she has already entered into the fire to prove her innocence. Again, she is as though like the blazing fire that is standing to show the purity again in front of the people of Ayodhya. Finally, after having come into Ayodhya, the first thing Rama does is he goes to the Dasharatha's palace. So he goes to Dasharatha's palace. And then again, he sees where Dasharatha lived and he again grieves about the death of his father. And then immediately he goes to Kaikeyi's palace. So till this point of time, Kaikeyi has not come to see Rama, Lakshmana or Bharata. Of course, by this time, she's already disgraced or she feels very shameful of what she has done. So she is already repenting. In the middle of this, Rama first goes and sees Kaikeyi. So he goes to Kaikeyi's palace and then he salutes her and tells it, "Oh Mata, oh mother, it is only because of you. You are the only person who is brave enough to remind our father Dasharatha of the promise he made to your father. And hence, it is because of you that our father did not, go away from the path of dharma. Because Pratignya Paripalanam is the dharma of Ikshvakumsha kings. And you were brave. So other people would have not thought of this, but you were the brave lady who made this point and made sure that Dasharatha did not go away from the path of dharma. And you were the main reason that Dasharatha attained Swarga. And then just by hearing these words of Rama, Kaikeyi's grief is totally removed. And she again comes out and again mingles. So till this point of time, she has been separated. She herself separated. Kausalya or Sumitra did not, taunt her, did not scold her for doing this. But still she, as a prayaschitta and as shame, she had herself separated herself. And now she again came and joined with the others. Now, after having done all this, the Rajyabhisheka is a long process. So he said, he does Atithi Satkara to all the Vanaras. He performs Atithi Satkara to Vibhishana, Sugriva, everything. And they stayed in Ayodhya for one fortnight. That is for 14, nearly 14 to 15 days, the entire army of Vanaras and, Vibhishana, Sugriva, all of them, they stayed at Ayodhya. And then they finally took leave. Then after having done all this, so till this point of time, Pushpaka Vimana is with Rama. But once the process is done, all the, tasks are finished, then Rama sends the Pushpaka Vimana back to Kubera. Now, Rama has started to rule the kingdom in a very just way. And how is this rule? Tenarthavan lobha paramukhena, tenagrhata vigna bhayena kriyavan, tenasaloka pitruman vinetra, teneiva shoka panudeva putri. Now, lobha paramukha. This Rama is a lobha paramukha. He is not greedy. So, the previous kings, they had to accumulate tax. So, they were collecting tax from the citizens. But Rama's rule was such that even there was no need to collect the tax at all. That was how prosperous Ayodhya was. And tena arthavan. So the people became more rich, or they became wealthy, because there was no tax that they had to pay. And whatever they earned, they could completely keep it to themselves. Tena ghnata vigna bhayena kriyavan. And he was a very good protector. He was strong enough to protect everything. Hence kriyavan, for any person who wanted to do any type of homa, havana, yaga, whatever, all his actions were vigna bhayam. So there was no fear of any disturbance or destruction of the acts. Hence, every person could fulfill their desires. And tena saloka, the entire world, because of the way Rama was protecting the kingdom, they considered himself to be the father. And tena eva shoka panudeva putri. And for the people who did not have children, Rama himself became the child. So even in the previous, when Dilipa Varadhanam was also being done, there also they told the fathers and mothers were just fathers and mothers because they gave birth, but Dilipa, because of the way he ruled, became the father. Similarly, Rama also, he was the person who became the father, as well as he was the person to that. He was also the son to all the childless people. Then, after having, settled in a very nice way, Rama and Sita, when they are, sitting together, they call artists from various parts of the world, and they ask them to draw whatever happened during the Vanavasa. So, whichever some incident that were very fresh in their mind, they asked the artists to paint those pictures. And this time, so when they were in Vanavasa, this all was a harsh moment. But now, after having settled down in the, Ayodhya, these thoughts became good memories for them. They started, relishing these memories more and more. Then, Rama finally came to know that Sita is bearing a child. So he's very happy. And finally, Sita also comes and tells Rama that I have a wish. That is, I want to go back to where we spent Vanavasa. That is, I want to go back to the forest. And again, I want to see those, sages, munis, and I want to do service to them. So she tells her, please make this arrangement for me. And Rama tells, okay, fine. Your wish will be fulfilled. So he tells that it will be fulfilled. After he promises this, Rama again goes back and he's engrossed in looking after the kingdom. So he is, involved in the ruling. And then at one point of time, a spy. So he has put a lot of spies, and one of them is called Bhadra. So Bhadra comes one day to Rama to tell whatever the developments he has come across in Ayodhya. And then Rama asks, okay, how are the people doing? How is the, Ayodhya? How are the people? How are they feeling? And then Bhadra is a little hesitant to tell. But then Rama tells, Nirbandha prishta sajagada sarvam stuvanti paurash charitam tvadiyam anyatra raksho bhavanoshitayaha parigrahan manava deva devyaha. So Nirbandha prishta. So Rama tells, he puts his hand on his shoulder and tells it, don't worry, don't fear, tell whatever you know and be open. Don't be afraid. After having been, given the Ashwasana by Rama that don't be afraid, yes, please tell what you know. Then that Bhadra will tell that all the people are praising your rule. Everyone is happy that Rama is the king and he's ruling very well. But there is just one thing that they don't like. That is Anyatra. Anyatra Rakshobhavana Ushitayaha. So they didn't like you getting Sita, who has been staying for a very long time in another person's palace. And who is that other person? He's a Rakshasa. So your all your works are being praised except for the one deed that bringing Sita back from a Rakshasa's palace where she had stayed for a very long time. So when Rama heard to this, he is, you know, he does not know what to do because he is heartbroken that people are thinking about this in such a way because she has proved her innocence, but still people are having such a bad thought about Sita. So he's very sad about this. Then, Kim Atma Nirvada Katham Upekshe Jayam Adosham Uta Santyajami Ittyeka Paksha Shaya Viklavatvat Asit Sadola Chala Chitta Vritti. So now he's having two thoughts. What should I do? First, let there can be only two possibilities. One, Kim Atma Nirvada Katham Upekshe. So shall I forget or, you know, not worry about what people are thinking? So shall I let go of whatever people are telling? Let them tell, I won't worry about it. Should I be like that? Or Adosh Jayam Adosham Uta Santyajami, or should I even let go of my wife, who's, I know she's pure, Adosham, she hasn't done no mistake, but still, should I let go of her? Should I let go of the words being told by the public, or should I let go of my wife, even though she's pure? What shall I do? So he's unable to decide, and Dola Chalavarti, similar to how a swing moves to and fro between two points, similarly, Rama is confused what he should do. Should he heed to the words of the people, or should he let go? Should he forget the words of the people, or should he let go of his wife? So he is having this confusion. Finally, what happens is he decides that after having thought for a long time, he decides that letting go of the wife is the right thing because api yashodhana nabhi yashaha gariyaha. For a person who feels that yashodhana, for a person who considers fame itself to be the money, fame itself to be the wealth, yashaha gariyaha, fame is the most important. So whatever be the reason, people are telling something that is causing infame to Ikshvaku Vamsha, then that should not happen. Hence, even though my wife is pure and she has done no mistake, still he decides to let go of Sita. So now, once this is decided, he calls all his brothers. And now it's actually a very happy situation that Rama has come back to Ayodhya, he's the king. But when the brothers come and see Rama, they see the sad face of Rama. When they ask what has happened, then he tells that, oh brothers, so some words have been coming in the, you know, citizens' mouths, which is, you know, causing a lot of damage and it's inflicting shame to Ikshvaku Vamsha. Hence, I want to tell you something. And beautifully he tells, Kalidasa puts it in the mouth of Rama, that Paureshu Soham Bahuli Bhavantam Apam Tarangeshviva Taila Bindum Sodhum Natatpuram Avarnamishe Alanikam Sthanu Riva Dvipendraha. So Pauraha, so the people are like water. And among the people, if you have a, you know, huge surface of water and you drop a drop of oil, what happens? The oil starts spreading fast. So he's saying, Rama is saying that, so the people are like water, and among them, a small insult that is in the form of this oil, that Sita is impure and Rama has done a wrong deed. This Taila Bindu, this oil drop has fallen into this water and it is spreading very fast. And Sodumna Tatpuram Avarnamisha, and I am unable to listen to this because it's like an elephant, similar to how an elephant does not like being tied to a tree. Similarly, I am unable to bear this insult that Ikshvaku Vamsha is being given. So beautifully it is that the people, there is, you know, how a drop of oil quickly spreads on the surface of water. This news of Sita being impure is spreading rapidly among the people of the city. And similar to how a mighty elephant does not tolerate being tied, I also cannot tolerate this news being spread. Hence, he tells it, I will let go of my wife. I will forsake my wife, even though she is pure. And also by this point of time, I've already told you Sita is with child. Hence, he tells it, even though I know that she is with child, still I have decided to let go of her. Why? Because I want this Ikshvaku Vamsha to not have any kalanka. Hence, I am taking this decision. And he tells it, please don't go, you know, don't oppose my decision and please follow my orders. Avaimi chainam anagheti kintu lokapavado balavan matome chayahi bhume shashino malatvena aropita shuddhi matah prajabhi. Avaimi, I know. Ainam anagheti, so I know that she is pure. Anagha is one who is spotless, one who is pure. So I know that for sure that Sita is pure. But lokapavado balavan matome. This is a very beautiful sentence that Kalidasa tells it. Lokapavado balavan matome. So lokapavada is public insult. So Rama is saying that even though I know she is pure, lokapavada is very strong. That is, the insult that people are creating is more strong. he's given us a very beautiful example that, see, everyone considers that, you know, the moon is impure, it has a lot of spots, it has a lot of blemishes, but it's actually bhumehe chaya. So the shadow of the earth is falling on the moon, which is creating those black patches. But still, people tell that moon is the one which has problems. So even though it's just a shadow that is falling of the earth on the moon, similar to how people are complaining about Chandra to be, you know, having a lot of blemishes or, you know, faults. Similarly, even though I know that she is pure, I am letting go of her because of fearing Lokapavada. He also tells, he tells his brothers, you may think that I fought Ravana to get Sita back. But no, please don't think like that. Understand that I fought Ravana because, see, I am a strong king. And Ravana came and took away my wife. So to prove that I am strong enough to, again, you know, get my wife back, I went and killed Ravana. It was not because I want to get Sita back and I liked her. Don't think like that. So again, Kalidasa is trying to make sure that Rama is telling this to make sure that he can let go of Sita. So he tells, please don't oppose my decision and all of you obey my orders. So at this point of time, he tells his brothers, so please follow my orders and take her away from this Ayodhya. But no brother comes ahead. So no one is ready to either accept his orders or no one is ready to even oppose the orders. And no one is also ready to leave Sita away. But then finally he decides, okay, Bharata and Shatrughna, they will neither accept my orders nor will they reject my orders. So the best person to ask is Lakshmana. So he calls Lakshmana and tells, Prajavati dohada shamsinite tapovaneshu sprihayalu reva sattvam rathi tadvyapadeshaniyam prapayya valmiki padam tyajinam. Prajavati, so this Sita, Prajavati, is with child. So she's pregnant. Dohada shamsini, and she's also the wife of your brother. What should you do? And how is she? Tapovaneshu sprihayalu. So she also has shown interest. So previously, Sita has told Rama that I want to go and spend some time in the forest. So Rama is telling that, see, Lakshmana, your sister-in-law, that is Sita, is with child. And she also has told that she desires to go back to the forest. So she also has that desire. Hence, what should you do? Satvam Rathi. So take her in the chariot and take her outside this Ayodhya and take her into the forest. And what should you do? Valmiki Padyam Tyajaina. Once reaching Valmiki's ashrama, leave her there. Tyajaina. So don't even go and give her to Valmiki. Just leave her there and come back. This is how Rama, you know, is telling Lakshmana to do this orders. And again, beautifully, the next shloka is one of the most beautiful shlokas of Valmiki, you know, Kalidasa's Raghuvamsham. Sashu Shruvan Matari Bhargavena Pitirniyogat Prahartam Dvishadvat Pragrihit Agraja Shasanam Tat Agnya Gurunam Hyavicharaniya. So, how did this Lakshmana? So, did Lakshmana accept it? Kalidasa beautifully tells it. Similar to how when Bhargava Purusharama was ordered by his father to cut off his mother's head, he, without even giving a second thought, Dvishadvata, like an enemy, similar to if two enemies are fighting, similar to how they kill each other without any mercy, that Bhargava, who had cut off the head of his mother on the orders of his father, similarly, even Lakshmana, without even thinking twice or, you know, without even showing any sort of discomfort, he agreed. Pratyagrahit, he accepted Agraja Shasanam, he accepted the orders of his brother. And here comes a very beautiful sentence. Agnya Gurunam Hyavicharaniya. The orders given by the elders should not be questioned. This is a very famous quote that you come across in so many places. So this comes in this part of Raghuvamsha. So now finally, after having accepted to the orders of Rama, Lakshmana takes Sita in the chariot and Sumantra is driving the chariot. Saniyamana ruchiran pradeshan priyankaromi priya ityanandate nabuddha kalpa drumatam vihaya jatam tamatmani asipatra vriksham. So Sita is unaware of what has happened. So she has not been told what is happening in Rama's mind. So saniyamana ruchiran pradeshan. So as desired by her, she thinks that priyankaromi priya. My husband is, you know, he loves me so much. Why? Because Ruchiran Pradeshan. So what I expected, I asked him, just I told him by words that I want to go back to the forest. And he became so ready that he so immediately made arrangements and he's sending me to Ruchiran Pradeshan, my desired place. So Rama is so, you know, he loves me so much that he's making arrangements to send me to the place I desire. But Nabuddha, so she is that Abuddha, she does not have any knowledge that Kalpadruma Tam Vihaya. So Kalpadruma is Kalpavriksha. So that Rama whom she thought to be Kalpadruma, Kalpavriksha, कल्पद्रुमताम विहाय ही हैज लेट गो ऑफ दैट एबिलिटी ऑफ बीइंग अ कल्प वृक्ष एंड असीपत्र वृक्षम व्हाट हैज ही बिकम असीपत्र असी इज स्वर्ड पत्र इज लीफ वृक्ष इज ट्री सो rather than being the kalpa vriksha that was giving away that was fulfilling the desires that rama has now become a tree whose leaves are as sharp as knives or blades or swords so beautifully kalidasa says that sita feels that rama is fulfilling her desire but she is unaware that that rama who was the bestower of wishes has now become the tree with sword leaves as sharp as swords now as she goes She is unaware that what is happening, but then at one point of time, her right eye starts blinking. And this is a sign of bad omen for women. But even at that point of time, what did she pray? So if any of us were there, we would have prayed, okay, please, there's some bad omen going on. Please save me from this. But what Sita prays is totally different. She prays that, oh Lord, I pray that nothing bad should happen to Rama and his brothers. That is what she prays. She does not pray for herself. She prays, let nothing bad happen to Rama and his brothers. She is worried that she's because she knows if Rama is safe and Rama is, you know, in a good place, surely she'll also be safe. So this is how she prays. Then finally, the chariot stops on the banks of Ganga. Lakshmana and Sita get down, and a tribal boat, a boat is ready on the banks of Ganga. Now, Sita is shocked. She does not know what is happening because they had to still go further. But now Sumantra is stopped the chariot. Lakshmana and Sita have got down, and the two Lakshmana is standing away. So he's not even accompanying Sita. He's just standing there, and Sita is asked to go towards the boat. Now, atha vyavasthita pita vakathanchita saumitri rantarkata bashpakantha. औत्पातिकं मेघ इवाश्म वर्षं महीपते शासन मुज्जगार एंड एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम अथ व्यवस्थापित वा कथंचित समहौ ही मस्टर्ड द करेज बिकॉज ही डज नॉट इवन हैव द करेज टू कन्वे द मैसेज सो समहौ ही मैनेज्ड टू गेन द करेज एंड गैदर्ड हिज वर्ड्स एंड अंतर्गत बाष्पकंठ एंड हिज वॉइस इज फिल्ड विद सॉरो इट्स फिल्ड विद टीयर्स एंड हाउ डिड ही यू नो हाउ वाज ही टेलिंग द ऑर्डर्स ऑफ रामा Megha, if a cloud, as though it is showering stones, so rain should be showered by the clouds. But here, in this case, the words coming out of Lakshmana's mouth is like stones being thrown by clouds. Autpatikam iva ashma varsham, rain of stones. So that type of shasanam ujjagara that Lakshmana told the orders of Rama, which were like stones falling from clouds. And again, Kalidasa, again, He has already told once what has to be done. What are the orders of Rama? And he also does not feel good to again repeat what is the Shasana. So again, nowhere after this, whatever the orders of Rama, Kalidasa has also mentioned, because that also indirectly tells you that it is such a harsh order that even Kalidasa does not feel like using it again and again. Now, after having heard to this, Sita falls unconscious. And here, see, Valmiki Ramayana is a very good Purana Grantha, Aitihasika Grantha. But when you read Kalidasa, the shlokas, what I will tell now, those type of shlokas is what makes Kalidasa Kavi Kula Guru or Mahakavi. Ikshvaku vamsha prabha kathamtvam tyachet akasmat patirarya vrittaha itikshitihi samshayiteva tasyai dadau pravesham janiniya tavat. Beautiful imagination by Kalidasa. Now, what has happened? Sita has fallen on the ground. But who is the mother of Sita? Bhudevi itself. So, Now let us take a situation. Let us say a wife has come from her husband's house into her mother's house. So in those times, the custom was whenever the daughter is coming, her husband should also accompany. Only in that case will the mother be happy and they'll welcome both of them. But if a daughter is coming alone without her husband, then it's actually not a good thing. So they usually don't allow women to come alone without their husband. So here also, the mother is Bhudevi. So Kalidasa has beautifully imagined that once Sita fell, it is as though she is asking entry into the earth, which is her matrigraha, the mother's house. She wants to enter into the mother's house. But what is the mother telling? Ikshvaku vamsha prabhava kathamtvam. How can a person born in the Ikshvaku vamsha be able to let go? Kyajet, how can you reject your wife without any reason? Akasmat, that too, without any reason. And suddenly, how can a person born in Ikshvaku vamsha let go of his wife having iti samshayiteva? Having hence doubted Rama's orders, Kshitihi, तस्यै प्रवेशं न ददौ दट मदर अर्थ डिड नॉट गिव एंट्री इनटू हर दट इज सी लेटर ऑन वी सी दट वंस यू नो सीता टेल्स इफ आई एम प्योर देन प्लीज ओपन अप एंड टेक मी दट इज द लास्ट पार्ट ऑफ उत्तर रामायण बट हियर she has fallen on the earth as though asking so Kalidasa's imagination she has fallen asking permission to enter into the earth but even that earth she also does not open up telling that there is no reason why Rama should have let go of you so I won't give you no entry into my place beautifully Kalidasa uses finally she you know when you know after a lot of time so Rama Lakshmana has taken a, Lakshmana never touches Sita So he does not know how to wake her up. So finally, he you know sprinkles some water, and finally she regains her consciousness. And Kalidasa beautifully tells us that Mohat Prabhut Kashta Taraf Prabodhah. So when she fell down unconscious, that was causing a little bit of pain in Lakshmana's heart. But Mohat Abhut Kashta Taraf, even more grieving or even more distressing than her unconsciousness was. When she gained back consciousness because once she gained back consciousness she started weeping so much that Lakshmana at one point of time felt that when she was unconscious itself it was better then she started again Kalidasa beautifully tells it even at this point of time Sita never criticizes Rama she never tells that Rama did a wrong thing Rama you know has done a mistake she always criticizes herself so she tells it okay probably it is something wrong in me something he found some fault in me hence he has let go of me she never criticizes Rama Then Lakshmana consoles and tells it, "Oh Mata, please forgive me. I never wanted to do this, but I am only following the orders of my brother. So please, I beg forgiveness for this mistake." Then Sita tells it, "Sita tamuttapya jagada vakyam pritosmite somya chiraya jiva bidau jasa Vishnu rivagrajena bhratraya dittham paravanasitvam." So Sita having lifted him up, then she tells it, "Oh Lakshmana, oh Somya, gentle one." You may live long. So, Chiraya Jeeva, you live long. And I know you're following your orders of your brother. Hence, you're not at all at fault. Similar to how Indra's, Vishnu took the form of Upendra. So, Upendra is Vamanavatara and he's considered Upendra, the son or the brother, younger brother of Indra. Hence, he's called Upendra. Similar to how Upendra was following the words of Indra, you are following the words of your elder brother Rama. Hence, you're not at fault. Hence, don't grieve. He also tells it. She tells that none of the mothers know, neither Sumitra, Kausalya, Kaikeyi, none of them know what is happening. So she tells that, so after realizing that none of them know, she tells that, oh Lakshmana, please go and pay my respects to my mothers and ask them, you know, seek their blessings for the child that is growing in me. So please go and do this for me. And then she also sends a message to Rama. Through Lakshmana, she tells that, okay, so, oh Rama, you were the person who witnessed the Agni Pariksha in front of me. Lanka. But just because of Lokapavada, even you are ready to forget that and send me and, send me away and let go of me. But you are the person who, is like the king who will rule everyone. So you are to be just and you should look after everyone equally. Hence, if not looking after me as a wife, please look after me as a citizen. So being a Raja, it is your duty that you should look after me as a citizen. So please at least do that. And she tells that, so probably I feel that there is some, so Rama is not at fault. So there is probably some Papa Karma that I have done in the previous life that I am experiencing this grief in my life. Upasthitam, and again, this is one of the, another beautiful way by which we understand Kalidasa's greatness in Kavya. Upasthitam purvamavasya lakshmim vanam maya sardhamasi prapannaha tadaspadam prapya tayati roshat sodhasmina tvadbhavane vasanti. So, Kalidasa beautifully tells that previously when you were given Rajalakshmi, so initially when Dasharatha told I will make you the king, what did I do? I took you away and took you to Vanavasa. So at that point of time, that Rajalakshmi felt very sad that Rama who had come to take her had been taken away by Sita. So now in order to avenge that anger, what this Rajalakshmi is doing is once Rama has become the king, he has made sure that Sita goes away. Because when Rajalakshmi wanted to spend some time with Rama, Sita took him away. So this time when Rama has come to Rajalakshmi, she has made sure that I go away so that she can spend all the time with Rama beautifully. So this is how Kalidasa has imagined this situation. Then she tells that I am the person who is the wife of Rama who is protecting everyone else. Now that Rama has also left me, whom shall I go and ask? And finally, so at this point of time, one may feel that Sita might feel very sad that she has been the wife of Rama. But साहम तपः सूर्य निविष्ट दृष्टि ऊर्ध्वं प्रसूतेश्चरितुं यतिष्ये भूयो यथा मे जननांतरेपि त्वमेव भर्ता न च विप्रयोगः. सो शी टेल्स, ओके सो रामा डोंट फील दैट आई हैव यू नो आई डोंट वांट टू बी योर वाइफ एनीमोर. शी टेल्स दैट once I give birth to this child, so because in this current state I cannot do any kind of tapas, so but be you know aware that once I give birth to this child, what will I do? Surya Nimishta Drishti, I will face that sun and I'll look into his eyes and I will do a ghora tapas. Why am I doing this tapas? Bhuyo yatame jananantarepi tvameva bharta. For all the lives that will come after this, for every life that I will take, every birth I will take, tvameva bharta, I will pray that you will always be my husband. But what is the change? Why am I doing this penance then? Na viprayogaha. But what I will pray for is, when you become my husband in the next births also, there should be no separation. Na viprayogaha. There should never be a separation. Because here, already she was separated during, you know, Vanavasa when Ravana abducted her. Now again she is being separated. So she is telling that, I will always ask that you should be my husband. And in the next birth, I want you to be my husband. And there should be no separation. So beautifully, this is a very beautiful shloka. Finally, Ravana, after having all told all this, Lakshmana left. Sita starts crying loudly. Once she starts crying loudly, the forest itself, being a Prakriti Kavi, Kalidasa tells it, listening to her crying so much, the peacocks that were dancing, they stopped dancing. The trees which were filled with flowers, they shed all their flowers. The grass, you know, that had, you know, the deer who had picked up the grass, even it left the grass, you know, they could stop eating. So it seemed as though the entire forest was grieving with her. At that point of time, Valmiki came there. And how is this Valmiki? He was the person who wrote the first Kavya, Adi Kavya, just by seeing a Krauncha Pakshi being killed. So here the first shloka of, you know, Valmiki Ramayana, that is, Om Manishad Pratishtham Tvam Agama Shashwati Samaha Yat Krauncha Mithunat Ekam Avadhihi Kama Mohitam. So this type of Valmiki, who had taken inspiration to write an Adi Kavya just by seeing a hunter killing a Krauncha Pakshi, that type of Valmiki approached there. So he blesses her. And he, you know, blesses her to get a good son and tells that, see, she should, you know, she consoles her. Sir, he consoles her telling that, see, even your father, Janaka also knows me. Even your father-in-law, Dasharatha also knows me. Hence, I am like your father itself. So, I have realized, I know what all has happened to you and why you have come here. Hence, I have come here to take you along with me. So, you can stay in my ashrama and I know I will look after your children. I will do all the samskaras that are necessary. And I will make sure that they will grow very well. So, having told all this, so... having told all this, he takes there and he tells, so once you come there, you can, once you mingle with all the people in my ashrama, you will feel consoled. So please come. So having said this, Valmiki took her and all the sannyasinis, they came, they built a separate hut for her. They made a separate bed and they made her be stay in that ashrama. Then again, Sita goes back to wearing those bark garments. So she serves all the guests who come. She lives only by eating the fruits that are growing there. And she's Only the reason she is continuing to live is because there is a successor to the Vamsha who is growing in her. So just to make sure that that Vamsha continues, she is staying. And Lakshmana, he returns and then he narrates whatever has happened. But why is he actually, after having left Sita, he comes back to Rama and he tells all what has happened, because he feels that if he tells that Sita is grieving so much, Sita is sad, then probably Rama might change his mind and he may ask Lakshmana to bring her back. But no, Rama, he was immediately filled with Sita. He was immediately filled with sorrow that he was separated from Sita. But then he did not, you know, change his mind and he kept quiet. Nigrahya shokam swayameva dhiman varnashramo vekshana jagarukaha sabhratra sadharana bhed bhoga madhrita rajyam rajorikta manashashasa. So in this way, that Rama was separated by Sita, nigrahya shokam, having controlled his sorrow, he continued to rule the kingdom along with his four brothers. But Rajoriktam, so the Rajoguna that is required to rule the kingdom, having let go of that, he was ruling the kingdom. That is, he was ruling the kingdom, but he was not enjoying the rule as a king would do because of the loss of Sita. So Rama never married another woman, and without another rival queen. So now Kalidasa beautifully considers that Raja Lakshmi as well as Sita were the two wives of Rama. So now, once Sita has gone away and Rama did not marry any other queen, Raja Lakshmi is the only queen for Rama and she is living happily, that Rama is only for her. Beautifully, Kalidasa has used this phrase. And Finally, the Chaturdasha Sarga ends with Sitam Hitva Dashamukha Ripuhu Nopameye Yadanyam Tasya Eva Pratikriti Sakho Yat Kratu Najagara Vrittenantena Shavana Vishaya Prepina Tena Bhartuhu Sadurdvaram Kathamapi Parityaga Dukham Vishehe. So, that Rama who had let go of Sita, Sitam Hitva, who had let go of Sita and who had killed Dashamukha Ravana, Na upameye, he did not take another wife. And who became his constant companion? Pratikriti Sakha. He made a murti, he made a golden statue of Sita, and that became his companion. Having listened to this, Vrittantena Shravana Vishaya, so having listened that Rama did not take another wife, and he, you know, still considered Sita to be his wife, somehow that Sita who came to know of this, Parityaga Dukkham Vishehe, she somehow controlled or she contained her sorrow. So with this, the 14th sarga ends. 15th sarga, Panchayadasha sarga starts with Rama is ruling the kingdom. So some sages come from the Yamuna, banks of Yamuna, telling that there is a asura called Lavanasura who is, you know, constantly troubling them. So then they ask Rama for protection and also tell that Lavanasura has a particular type of Trishula. Only when he does not have the Trishula can he be destroyed. So they give this message as well. So then Rama calls Shatrughna and tells, go and, you know, kill Lavanasura and establish peace. So Shatrughna again starts with starts with an army to go and kill Lavanasura. On the way, they go towards Valmiki Ashrama. So on the path to Lavanasura's place itself, Valmiki Ashrama comes. So they stay there for some time. They rest there and Valmiki welcomes them. And on that same night when Shatrughna came, Sita gave birth to two kids. So that this is informed to Shatrughna, who is very happy. But again, once he comes to know, the next day he does not wait there, but he continues on his mission. So Shatrughna reaches Madhupagna. So that is the capital of Lavanasura. So having reached Madhupagna, he fought and won over Lavanasura. Of course, they give a detailed way of how he killed, which astras they used, finally, how did, you know, Shatrughna kill. But finally, Lavanasura is killed and Shatrughna establishes the city called Mathura on the banks of Yamuna. And he started ruling that Mathura kingdom under his rule and peace was established. So in the meantime, so here Valmiki Sashrama, those two kids have come to an age where the Namakarana Samskara has to be done. So Valmiki, being the person well known in all the, you know, rituals and, you know, Puranas, he names them Kusha and Lava. So the elder brother is named Kusha and the younger brother is named Lava. And both these words, Kusha as well as Lava, so Kusha is taken from Kusha grass and Lava is considered to be another type. So there are two, you know, meanings for Lava. So one is, it's also another type of grass similar to Kusha grass. And another thing is, it is a tail hair of a cow. So a cow's tail has some hair. That hair is called Lava. So why he named these was Kusha grass as well as this hair of the, you know, cow's tail, both are very purifying. So whenever you want to do any type of purification, let us say after Amavasya, everything, you break these Kusha grass or you use these hairs of cow's tail to purify it. So similarly, since these kids purified the Ikshvaku Vamsha, they were named Kusha and Lava. So he taught, you know, Valmiki taught them all the Vedas, Vedangas, everything. And finally, he also taught them Ramayana. It was his own creation. He taught that Ramayana. So, Ramasya Madhuram Vrittham Gayanto Matu Ragrataha Tadviyoga Vyatham Kinchita Shithili Chakratuhu Sutav. So, those Rava Kusha, they were also taught music. So Valmiki even also taught them music. So having learnt music and having learnt Ramayana, they started singing Ramayana shlokas in front of their mother. Listening to these shlokas, that mother, you know, was able to, you know, that sorrow that was building up in Sita somehow reduced by constantly listening to Ramayana shlokas being recited by Lava and Kusha. So the all the other three Raghavas, so this is about Rama and Lakshmana, this is about Rama. So he begetted two sons. Similarly, the other three Raghavas, that is Bharata, Shatrughna, as well as Lakshmana, they also begetted two sons each. So finally, Shatrughna entrusted Mathura to Bahushruta and Vidisha. So Shatrughna's sons are called Bahushruta and Subahu. So these are the two sons of Shatrughna. So he made Bahushruta the king of Mathura and he made Subahu, the king of Vidisha, and returned to Rama. So after having returned to, you know, Ayodhya and Rama, everyone praised that, you know, even Rama is also praising, all the people are praising how, you know, valorous or how strong, you know, Shatrughna was and how he defeated Lavanasura. Then after some time, what happens? So now Ramarajya is happily going on. But at one point of time, what happens is there is a Brahmana who, in front of the Brahmana itself, his young son is dead. So actually, in those points of, you know, when Ramaraja is going on, everything is subhiksha, everything is very good, prosperous, everything. So untimely death, that is, yeah, death at a very young age and all, was not very common. It was not happening at all. But at this point of time, what happens is, right in front of the Brahmana, his young son dies. So that young son, that Brahmana brings the dead body of that young son to the court of Rama and weeps. And he tells that, no, I don't know what is the cause of this problems, and Rama should rectify this. So Rama was shocked that how can this be possible? Untimely death has never been there in the life, you know, in the rule of Ikshvaku kings. Why is this happening? So finally, he heard an Asharira Vani. So he hears an Asharira Vani, which tells that, so there is a crime that is going on in your kingdom. So eliminate that and fulfill your duty, and then you'll again, you know, regain the prosperity. At that point of time, Rama thinks about Pushpaka Vimana, and Pushpaka Vimana immediately appears. So he sits in the Pushpaka Vimana and he starts going around the kingdom, looking at what is happening and what is the cause of the crime. There he finds a man who is performing a penance. And how is he performing the penance? He's hanging upside down from a tree. So having hung upside down from a tree, he's performing a penance, and there is a big fire, Homa, that is being done. And that Homa's smoke is all coming to the face of that person who is doing the penance. Rama comes and inquires, so who are you? Why are you doing this penance? So he tells it, my name is Shambhuka. I am a Shudra and I'm performing this yajna to attain Swarga. So actually what happens is, according to Varnashrama rule, Shudra is not entitled to do a Homa for attaining Swarga. Only it is based on how he, you know, does his job, he'll attain Swarga. He cannot perform a penance. Also, secondly, he is doing it for his Swartha. For his selfish needs, he's doing a penance. Hence, that is the main reason for all these problems to be occurring in Ayodhya. So realizing that the selfish penance is the cause of all the problems, Rama cut his head. That is, he, you know, eliminated him, and he starts coming back towards Ayodhya. So after having done this, the, you know, prosperity is regained. But on his way back, he meets Agastya. So Agastya is very pleased with how Rama is ruling the kingdom. So he is, you know, Samudra Deva would have given Agastya a bracelet. So he gives that bracelet to Rama. So Rama accepts that bracelet and he's on the way. Even before Rama comes back to Ayodhya, that Brahmana Kumara, that young son of the Brahmana, he's again comes back to life. So it means that on killing Shambhuka, the prosperity is regained and the problems have been eliminated. So even before Rama could reach Ayodhya, the, you know, Brahmana's son has come back to life. And what did he do? Tasya purvoditam nindam dvijah putra samagataha stutva nirvartayamasa kratuhu vaivasvatadapi. So that Brahmana, who was previously criticizing Rama, he was telling that, oh Rama, see, you should be capable, you are not doing your jobs. He was criticizing Rama. That Brahmana who was criticizing Rama initially, once he got back, putra sangamat, once he regained his son, stutva, he praised Rama. What did he praise him as? Ratuhu vaivasvatadapi. So vaivasvata, so vivasvan is Surya, vaivasvata is Yama. So he is praising Rama that he is a protector even from Yama, because he regained his son's life. Brahmana is praising that you are the person who can protect the citizens even from Yama. So once this is done, Kula Gurus and all the other Purohitas, they advise Rama that, okay Rama, it's now time to do the Ashwamedha Yajna. So now Rama performs the Yajna and he releases the Ashwamedha horse. So Dibhyo Nimantritash Chainam Abhijagmuhu Maharshayaha Hitvajyotirmayanyapi. So now, in order to experience, so Rama being such a great ruler and he doing such a great Ashwamedha Yajna, he calls people from all around the place. Dibhyo Nimantritaha. So Maharshayaha, the sages are, you know, coming from all the directions. And now Bhumyanyeva, they are not just coming from different parts of the earth. Jyotirmayanyapi, they are coming from different galaxies. So there are some rishis who are staying in some other galaxies. So it is not like only the people on earth are coming to see, witness this Ashwamedha Yajna. Sages from different galaxies and different nakshatra mandalas are also coming to witness this great sacrifice. Apashalya nivishtai staihi chaturdvara mukhi babhau Ayodhya srishta lokeva sadyav paitamahi tanuhu. So that Ayodhya had four doors, that is four entrances. So the number of people who are coming into this Ayodhya is so enormous. And of course, they know they are all making tents outside the gates of these Ayodhya. So the four gates of Ayodhya is now filled with so many tents and so many people are constantly coming. And Kalidasa beautifully tells that this Ayodhya, whose four gateways are filled with so many people, looks like the four-headed Brahma who is starting creation, similar to how Brahma was when he started creation with four heads. This Ayodhya looks similar to that same Brahma who is starting his creation. So Rama then became the Yajamana of the Yajna, but then who, there should always be a Sahadharmachari, that is the wife of the Yajamana, and that Sahadharmachari for the Yajna was the golden statue of Sita. And what is the beauty of this Yajna? Asan yatra kriya vigna rakshasa eva rakshinaha. So till this point of time, till Rama became the ruler, what was the problem with doing Yajnas? Rakshasas were the kriya vigna. So they were the disturbers or the destroyers of Yajnas, but they eva rakshinaha. But in Rama's Ashwamedha Yajna, those rakshasas themselves were the protectors of the yagas. So that is how great Rama's rule was. So then, being encouraged by Guru Valmiki, Lava, Kusha are told to go out and, you know, sing Ramayana in their beautiful voices in several places. Vrittantam Ramasya Valmikehe Kritihi Tau Kinnarasvanau Kim Tadanyena Manohartum Alam Syatam Nashrunvatam. So, Kalidasa beautifully tells that Vrittam Ramasya. First of all, it is a story of Rama, who is himself great. Valmikehe Kritihi. On top of that, it is the work written by the great sage Valmiki. On top of that, Tau Kinnaraswarau, the people who were singing, those two boys were Kinnaraswarau. They had the voice of Kinnaras. So Kinnaras are the demigods who are known for their immense and beautiful music. So first of all, it's a story of Rama. Second of all, it is a work written by Valmiki. And third of all, on top of all this, these two people who are singing in beautiful voices. So Kim Tadanyena Manohartum. So what else is not enough to attract the people, attract the listeners? Tadgita Shravanaikagra Sansadashrubhivi Sansadashrumukhi Babhau Himanishyandini Prataha Nirvateva Vanasthali. So Sansadaha, the listeners or the people, Tad Gita Shravana Ekagra. So they were so engrossed in the way, in the Ramayana that was being sung by Lavakusha, Ashrumukhi Babhu. So they became filled with tears, because the story does not just end with Rama being a very good king. It starts with Vanavasadi, you know, tough times that Rama and Sita face. So because of that, you know, heart-touching story, the people there are filled with tears. And also, they also have come to a point where Rama has left Sita. So listening to all these incidents, the listeners are filled with tears. And how are these tears being shed? Himanishyandini prataha nirvateva vanasthali. So in a forest, let us say, you know, in the night, because of the cold weather, dew or, you know, hima is accumulated on the leaves. But if there is no wind, what happens in the morning? When the sun rays come, these dew drops accumulate and fall down as drops or water. Similarly, these listeners were filled with tears. Bayo Veshavi Samvadi Ramasya Tayostada Janata Preksha Sadrishyam Nakshi Kampam Yatishthata. So these people saw Lavakusha. And how, what did they feel? Bayo Veshavi Samvadi. So in Vaya, in the age, in the physical boy appearance, as well as in the way they speak, Ramasya Tayostada, they saw a lot of sadrishya, they saw a lot of similarity between Rama and these two boys. And having observed this, how did they see? Nakshi Kampam Yatishthata, they started looking at them without even blinking. So they observed large amount of similarities between Rama as well as Lavakusha. So later, Rama is told that, you know, these two boys are, you know, singing in a very good way, so you should listen to them. So Rama invites them. And after listening to how they, you know, beautifully narrated Ramayana, Rama asks, who is your teacher? Who is the composer of this work? So they tell for both these questions, the answer is Valmiki. So, Athasa Varajo Rama Prachetasam Upe Ivan Uri Krityatmano Deham Rajyamasmai Nyavedayata. So he was so moved by how beautifully Valmiki had composed Ramayana that he went along with all his brothers to Valmiki's ashrama and Uri Krityatmano. So except for his body, Tasmai Rajyam Nyavedayat. He told, all my kingdom, all my wealth, all my prosperity is now yours. So he was so impressed by Valmiki's Ramayana that he told, except for his own body, except leaving his body, he told, whatever I have, my Rajya, my Aishwarya, everything is now yours. But then Valmiki told, oh Rama, I don't want any of these. Then finally he reveals that these two boys, Lava as well as Kusha, are your sons born to Sita. And he tells, now please take these two sons along with your wife and go back to Ayodhya. At that point of time, Rama tells, Tata Shuddha Samaksham Naha Snushate Jata Vedasi Dauratnya Drakshasastantu Natratyaha Shraddhaduf Prajaha Tahswa Charitya Muddishya Pratyayaitu Maithili Tata Putravati Mena pratipatsye tvadagnaya. So Tata, he calls Valmiki as Tata, because as we have seen, Valmiki was very close to Dasharatha as well as Janaka. So they, it's very common to call them as father or even elder one. So he says that, I know that, you know, Sita has proved her innocence and her purity in front of me, Jata Vedasi, in the fire, in Lanka. But the problem is the people here, Na Atratya Shuddhadhu Prajaha, the people here are not able to conceive the purity that she has already shown. Hence, he finally tells that, Taha Swacharitra Muddishya, let Sita again prove her purity in front of these people. And then, Tataha Putravati Menam, hence this lady who is with child, so Putravati, one who has children. So, Sita, so it means that I will take both Lavakusha as well as Sita. So, it is that, let her prove her innocence again in front of the people of Ayodhya. Then, Tvadagnaya, as ordered by you, I will take Lavakusha as well as Sita along with me to Ayodhya. So then, finally, you know, the Valmiki tells, okay, let it, okay. Then he'll tell that, okay, we'll do that. So then the next day, Rama has gathered all the citizens and he's inviting Valmiki. And Valmiki has come with Sita with her two sons. So, Kashaya Pariviteva, Pakashaya Parivitena, Sapada Chita Chakshusha, Anvamiyata Shuddheti, Shanteti Vapushaivasa. So, how is this Sita? Kashaya Parivitena. So, she's wearing a bark dress. And how is her eyes? She's not looking at people, she's not looking at Rama. Swapada Chita Chakshu. So, her eyes are looking at the ground. And just by seeing how, you know, nobly and how, you know, in a very Pativrata manner she's standing, just by looking at it itself, people had been guaranteed that she's pure. Anvamita Shuddheti. So, they just by looking at how Sita was standing, the people were sure that she's pure. Then, Tam drishti vishaye bhartuhu munirastita vishtaraha kuru sanisham sayam vatse swavritte lokamityatha ityashad. So that Valmiki, he is now plain or made to sit on a very uchitasana. After having sat there, then Valmiki tells, bhartuhu drishti vishaye, in front of your husband, kuru nisham sayam, make the people of Ayodhya nisham sayam, you know, make them doubtless about her character. He gives this words. Then, beautifully, this is a very nice shloka. Vang manah karma bhi patyau vyabhicharo yathaname tatha vishwambhare devi mam antar dhatumarhasi. Vang manah karma bhihi, by speech, by thought, or by action. If I have never violated my duty as a pativrata to my husband, then vishwambhare devi, O Lordess Bhumi Devi, or O Mother Earth, mam antar dhatumarhasi, then you should take me into your womb. Beautifully, this shloka is mentioned. Immediately, the earth opens, Bhudevi comes, and you know, the breaking of the earth itself is like the sound of lightning, and Bhudevi comes seated on a golden throne, and she appears before Sita. Sa Sita mankamaropya, bhartru pranahite kshanam, mameti vyaharatyeva, tasmin padanam abhyakat. So, that Bhudevi who came, so she praised Sita on her anka, on her thigh, and she went inside the earth. And ma meti, ma iti, vyaharatyeva. Even as Rama is saying, ma, do not take Sita. Even as he's telling this, tasmin patanam abhyakat, that Bhudevi took Sita to Patala Loka. Then finally, Rama is now, you know, eager to get Sita back. So he takes his bow and arrow and tries to shoot an arrow at the earth. At that point of time, Valmiki comes and stops him and tells it, Vidibala pekshi, the fate is all powerful, so don't worry. So whatever has happened is fate, you cannot go beyond that, so stop your efforts. So after having done all this, so he started the Ashwamedha Yajna, so it has to be completed. So somehow with you know, lot of grief, he completes the sacrifice. He, you know, does proper Atithi Satkara and sends all the sages and all the, you know, friends and, you know, kings who have come. He does all the Atithi Satkara and sends them back. And then Rama Sita Gatam Sneham Nidade Tat Nidade Apatya Yoho. So the love or the, you know, affection that Rama had for Sita, he now showered that entire affection on Tat Apatya Yoho, on the sons of Sita, that is Lava and Kusha. So now Rama, on the advice of Yudhajit, so Yudhajit is the maternal uncle of Bharata, so he makes Bharata the king of Sindhu Desha. Then Bharata has won over the Gandharvas in that Sindhu Desha, and later, he, you know, Bharata's sons are called Taksha and Pushkala. So these are the two sons, and he makes them the kings of cities named after them. So he creates a new city, or he establishes a new city called Taksha and makes his son Taksha the ruler of it. He establishes another city called Pushkala and he makes Pushkala his son also the king of that place. So the name of the place as well as the king, that is Bharata's sons, are also the same. And after having put those two sons on the thrones, Bharata again comes back to Rama. Lakshmana also, he made his sons Angada and Chandraketu, the kings of Karapatha, and he comes back to Rama. So, Upetya Munivesotha, Kalav Provacha Raghavam, Rahasamvadino Pashyet, Avam Yastam Tyajet Iti. So, after having done all this, all the four brothers are now together. And now what happens is, Kala, that is Yama, comes in the form of a Muni. And he asks a promise from Rama. What did he ask promise? That Avam Rahas Samvadino. So I want to discuss some secret with you. And if any person comes and listens or even comes and sees us talking, then Tyajehe, you should reject or you should let go of them. So this is the condition that Yama in the form of a Muni comes and asks. And Rama tells, okay. After this, Yama shows his true self and he tells it, so I am Yama. So your job here is done. You were sent here to, you know, kill Ravana. So your job here is done. So this is, means to again end your avatara. So please accept this. So after this is done, so they both are discussing. But what happens is now Durvasa is coming to Ayodhya. Lakshmana is aware. So, you know, Rama has sent the orders that no one should come and meet me. And I know it is against, it's an order that no one should come and meet. Lakshmana also knows this, but seeing Durvasa comes, so Durvasa is known for his anger. So he does not even think what will happen to him. So he does not want Durvasa to come and curse Rama. So even though he is aware of the orders or the conditions of Rama, he comes and interrupts the conversation that is happening between Rama and Yama. And he is again according to the orders. So he conveys his message and he understands, I've broken the orders, so I should be punished. So he has to separate himself from Rama. But we know Lakshmana and Rama are one pair. So being unable to, you know, be separated from Rama, what Lakshmana does is he goes to the banks of Sarayu and he, you know, leaves this body and through yoga and he goes to the higher worlds as Adishesha. Next, Rama now he makes the Kusha, the king of Kushavati. So he has two sons, as you know, Kusha and Lava. So Kusha is made the king of Kushavati, Lava is made the king of Sharavati, and then Rama starts going to the north along with his brothers. So several citizens and monkeys who were affectionate towards Rama, who liked him a lot, they also started following him. And what happened here is, Upasthita Vimanena Tena Bhaktanu Kampina Chakre Tridiva Nishrenhi Sarayuhu Anuyayena. So now Rama has come in Pushpaka Vimana to Sarayu. So this is a place where Rama will leave Bhumi and he'll leave for the higher world, that is, he'll go back to his Vaikuntha. But there are so many people, Anuyayinam, there are so many followers of Rama. So what did Rama do to them? Bhaktanukampina. So Rama is a person who is affectionate towards his followers. So what did he do? Sarayuhu Tridiva Nishrenhi. So he made Sarayu itself the staircase to Swarga. So while Rama was going back to Vaikuntha, he made sure that Sarayu became the means by which his followers could attain Swarga, and that became the staircase to Swarga. So, yadgo pratara kalpo bhut sammardas tatra majjatam atastadakhyaya tirtham pavanam bhuvi paprathe. So that place, similar. So if there is a river and there are several cows that are crossing that river, then that path is called Gopratara. So Gopratara is the path where so many cows enter into the river and they cross. So this Sarayu has become the crossing between the current world and the higher worlds. So beautifully, Kalidasa has told that this Sarayu became the Gopratara for the people, and having Majjatam, having dipped themselves in these Sarayu waters, the people attained higher worlds, and this became a Punyakshetra, Tirtham. And even today, Gopratara is a very, Gopratara or Guptar Ghat is a very famous place. And here is where Rama, along with all his Anuyayis, reached the higher worlds. So then, Rama, there were several gods who had come and helped Rama. So all the Vanaras were none other than the Devatas in themselves. So once they entered into Sarayu and took a bath, they again regained their forms and they went back to their lokas. And again, there were other people who were neither Devatas nor any of those divine people. So even they had to come to Swarga. But Swarga became very, clumsy, because there were, very less space in Swarga. So in Valmiki Ramayana, actually, it is told that heaven became so overcrowded that a second heaven had to be created for the people who came. So in this way, निर्वर्त्यैवं दशमुख शिरच्छेदकार्यं सुराणां विश्वक्सेन स्वतनुम अवशत सर्वलोक प्रतिष्ठां लंकानाथं पवनतनयं चोभयं स्थापयित्वा कीर्तिस्तंभ द्वयम् इव गिरौ दक्षिणे चोत्तरे च. सो ब्यूटिफुली कालिदास कंक्लूड्स पंचादश सर्ग टेलिंग दैट निर्वर्तय हैविंग हेंस कंप्लीटेड व्हाट दशमुख शिरच्छेदकार्य द वर्क ऑफ किलिंग रावण सुराणां. And who gave this work, or whose work was this? Suranam, the gods. So the having hence completed the work of the gods of killing Ravana, Vishvaksena, that is Vishnu, Swatanum Avishat, he came back to his actual celestial body. And Loka Pratishtham, and how was the celestial body? It was the one that pleased the entire world. And during Ramatara, Kalidasa beautifully mentions that Lankanatha, so the king of Lanka, that is Vibhishana, Pavanatanaya, that is Hanuman. So what did they two become? He, you know, established them as Kirtistambha. So they became the two Kirtistambhas, or the monumental pillars, one in the south, that is in Lanka, and one in the north, that is in India. So these two people, Vibhishana as well as Hanuman, became the Kirtistambhas for Rama's life on earth. Beautifully, by telling this, the 15th sarga ends. So the 16th sarga starts like this. So the seven brothers of, you know, Kusha is the eldest among the seven brothers. So he is the eldest, and he is, you know, considered the best among all of them. So he is ruling all the people, all the brothers are ruling under his kingdom. So the kingdom is prosperous, and the kingdom is going on very well. But at this point of time, Kusha sees a dream. So Kusha sees that there is a woman who has come without a husband. And when asking, who is she? She tells it, I am Ayodhya. So previously, all the people of Ikshvaku, they ruled from Ayodhya, and I was a very prosperous lady. But when you have left Ayodhya and come here, I have become barren and I have lost all my prosperity. So she tells, please come back to Ayodhya and start ruling from there. So listening to this, Kusha feels it. Okay, yes, this is a right thing to do. So he gives Kushavati to some Brahmins. So he gives, entrusts the, you know, matters of Kushavati to some Brahmins, and he goes to Ayodhya and makes it again. He brings back the prosperity to Ayodhya. Then in the summer, Kusha goes for a swim in the Sarayu, and Rama would have given that bracelet. So Agastya would have given a bracelet to Rama. Rama would have given it to Kusha. So when he's swimming, that bracelet would have got lost. And when the fishermen tell that there is a Naga, Deva, who's living in this Sarayu, so then Kusha decides that he should shoot an arrow to get it. But then the king of the serpents, Kumuda, comes with his sister called Kumudvati. And he tells it, okay, Kusha, it was not an intention to take away or, steal your Abharana. But my sister Kushavati, when she was playing, she found this and she kept it with herself. So please forgive this. So Kusha will tell that, okay, fine, I will forgive you. But then Kumuda also tells that, please marry my sister Kumudvati. And then finally Kusha agrees and he marries Kumudvati. So this ends the 16th sarga. In the 17th sarga, Kusha gets a son named Atithi from Kumudvati. And he is also, as you know, he is a child. He learns all the marriages, and he reaches a marriageable age, and he is married to princesses of different provinces. Later, when Kusha is helping Indra to fight a demon called Durjaya, Kusha kills the demon, but because of the battle, he also dies. So ministers make Atithi the king, and he is a very just king, and he is under the guidance of Vasishta. He starts administering very well, and so now the people are also very prosperous, and rather than winning the enemies outside, here it is told that Atithi started winning the enemies inside, that is Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Mada, Matsara. So these six enemies, Atithi was able to win over them. So once one person wins over these six enemies, then the other enemies outside are very negligible. So this here, Atithi is ruling very well. But again, as you can see, once Rama has finished his rule, the kingdom starts degrading its, prominence a little by little. And here, it is told that Atithi even had to, appoint spies for the safety of his kingdom. And, the politics that we see now that has started coming into Atithi. So previously when Rama and, Dasharatha, they were all ruling, they were very capable rulers and they did not need all these types of politics. But here when Atithi has started ruling, there are several types of politics that are involved. And, Kalidasa goes into the details of the politics as how he is ruling, how many spies he has allotted, etc. Then he again performs the Ashwamedha Yajna, and he's a very prosperous ruler. And Indra Shaval reigns. Yama made sure that there are no diseases, that is, he limited the deaths that were happening. Varuna made the rivers prosperous, and Kubera increased the treasury. So in this way, Atithi's rule has come to an end. So Atithi marries queen of Nishadha Desha, and he gets a son called Nishadha. So after this, 18th sarga starts with the birth of Nishadha. So the 18th sarga is dedicated to the lineage. So here Kalidasa uses one or two shlokas to explain who came after whom and how was the rule. I won't go into the details. I'll just tell you who were the kings who came next. So Nishadha son was called Nala. Nala was followed by Nabha. Then Pundarika, Kshemadhanva, Devanika, Ahinagu, Pariyatra, Shila, Unnabha, Vajranabha, Shanakha, Vyushitashva, Vishwasaha, Hiranyanabha, Kausalya, Brahmishta, Putra, Pushya, Dhruvasandhi, and Sudarshana. So again, Kalidasa has gone into the details of nearly 20 to 25 rulers after Kusha himself. So after explaining briefly about all this, he comes to Sudarshana. So he has explained a lot about Sudarshana because Sudarshana became a king when he was just 6 years old. Even as a child, even though he was just 6 years old, his rule was very great. And even as a child, he, you know, acted like a true king. But later, Sudarshana, so this is the end of 18th Sarga. Ashtadasha Sarga ends with the lineage of Ikshvaku Vamsha after Kusha as well as Atithi. 19th Sarga is the last Sarga. So Sudarshana begets a son called Agnivarna. So Sudarshana, actually, you know, Sudarshana's father would have died by a lion. So he would have become the king. After a prosperous life and after having, you know, ruled a very, you know, very nice, having ruled very well, he made his son Agnivarna the king and he takes Vanaprastha. But Agnivarna is a very, he does not rule very well. For him, the kingdom has come to him without any effort. So he did not fight, he did not go for war. The kingdom has been given to him by his father Sudarshana. And this Agnivarna is a very, you know, not a very good ruler. He's not interested in politics, he's not interested in ruling, but he's only interested in enjoyment. So he does not think about the welfare of the kingdom. He does not think about the welfare of the subjects. And finally, he involves in excess of drinking, Madira, Pana, etc. He shows a lot of interest in music, but not in ruling the kingdom. And he puts all the, you know, ruling powers into the ministers. And it is even told by Kalidasa that the people never even got to see the face of Agnivarna. Whenever he used to, you know, be, you know, go on a hunting mission, probably they used to see his face, but never did he call and he meet the, you know, he never met the people, he never met the public at all, and they never had the opportunity to see his face as well. And finally, Kalidasa beautifully tells, there were so many enemies outside the kingdom, but just because of the power of Ikshvaku Vamsha, the name Ikshvaku Vamsha itself was so powerful that these enemies could not attack Agnivarna's kingdom. So even though Agnivarna was a very weak king, he did not have any power, he did not know how to fight, but still that name of Ikshvaku Vamsha was so powerful that there was no way that the, you know, enemies could come and attack. But illness, Vyadhi, was the only thing that would attack Agnivarna. So the illness invaded Agnivarna, and because of his excess drinking, he was, you know, diagnosed with, you know, lot of diseases. But even though the, you know, physicians told that he should stop drinking everything, but Agnivarna does not, you know, accept. He becomes very pale, he becomes very weak, and he's even unable to stand on his own. And when people ask, whenever they see Agnivarna and they see that he's so weak, they ask him, what is happening to our king? They tell that for the welfare of the kingdom, our Agnivarna is doing an upavasa tapa, so he's becoming weak. It is all for the welfare of the kingdom. And beautifully, Kalidasa tells that Vyoma Paschima Kala Sthiti Induva Pankashesham Iva Karma Palvalam Ragnitat Kulam Abhut Kshayature Vamana Chiriva Deepa Bhajanam. Similar to how at the end of, you know, after Purnima, in the last day, on the 13th day, how you have the last phase of the moon just before Amavasya, or similar to how in the summer, just before the rains come, there is a last puddle of water, or similar to how there is a small flame that is flickering a lot before it blows off. Similarly, Agnivarna was that last king of the Ikshvaku Vamsha before the Ikshvaku Vamsha ended. So similarly, even before, so he had a lot of wives, but still, you know, none of them were bearing any children. So even before he could get any news of a child being born, that person, similar to this Amavasya moon, ended his life, and he could not even control, he could not even, you know, hold with his life before the birth of the child, and he dies. The princes, you know, the priests come and perform the, you know, Antima Samskara. And of course, the people should have actually gathered for such a Punya Karya, but the people were so scared that enemies might attack, thinking that there is no king, they might attack. So what they do is, in the backyard of the palace itself, they do Antima Samskara. And when the people come and ask, there is some fire going on in the backyard, they tell that, no, we are performing a Homa for the, you know, welfare of the kingdom. So don't worry, it's just a Yajna being performed. So even the Antima Samskara of Agnivarna is also not made public to the people, because the kingdom is so weak. Then finally, once, you know, Agnivarna has died, Then they come to know that one of the queens is bearing a child. And finally, that queen who is bearing the child is made to sit on the king, you know, throne as the queen, as the Rajamata. And then, tam bhavartham prasava samaya kankshininam prajanam antargudham kshitiriva nabho bija mushtim dadhana maulai sadham sthavira sachivaihi hema simhasanastha ragni rajyam vidhivashat ashishat bharturavyah tarnya. So that queen who was eager, or who, you know, whose womb was you know, bearing the successor of the clan, similar to how ground holds a bija, a seed, before it sprouts, similarly that queen sat on that golden throne and under the guidance of the ministers justly gave orders, and she was eager to give birth to the next successor of Raghuvamsha. So in this way, this last shloka ends the Navadasha Sarga, that is the 19th Sarga of Raghuvamsha, and this is the last shloka of Raghuvamsha itself. So this means that it is seen in every historic aspect. Whenever there is a kingdom that is established, there is a peak wherein the, you know, kingdom becomes very strong, very powerful, and very, you know, famous. Similarly, here we had Raghu, Dilipa, Dasharatha, Rama, all these people, they increased a lot, and Rama was the peak when, you know, Ikshvakuvamsha or Raghuvamsha became very prominent. But after that, similar to any dynasty will never stay in the peak forever. Similarly, after Rama also, it started slowly degrading, and Agnivarna was the last point of Ikshvakuvamsha where the Raghuvamsha ended. And in this way, Kalidasa beautifully concludes this Mahakavya called Raghuvamsha. So now, we'll again, after describing all this, the final motivation or the intention is to come back to the Sukti. So the Sukti that we are discussing here is Pratibadhnati Hishreya Pujya Puja Vyatikramaha. So where does this come? So after having gone through all the 19 sargas, finally we go back to the very first sarga. So very first sarga is where you will find this stukti called Pratibadhnati Hishreya Puja Puja Vyatikramaha. So now we know that Vasishta would have told, I know, Dilipa, that the reason for you to not have any children is because of the curse of Kamadhenu. So after having told that, so, you know, Vasishta, by his yoga maya, you know, yoga powers, he would have told that, so Kamadhenu was cursed to that until you worship the, you know, daughter of Kamadhenu, you will not beget any son. So after telling that, Kalidasa beautifully puts this in words that Pratibadhnati Hishreya Pujya Puja Vyatikramaha. That is, Pratibadhnati, it withholds, Tade Hidiyut Tade, what Shreya, the fame, Shreya Sannu, or fame, is withheld by Pujya Puja Vyatikramaha. If you do not worship the worshipable, then your fame is withheld. Pujya Rannu Pujisade Irudarinda, Shreyasu Tade Hidiyal Paduttade. Not worshipping a worshipable person withholds fame. So this is the meaning of the sukti, Pratibadhnati Hishteya Pujya Puja Vyatikramaha. So with this, we have concluded Raghuvamsha, as well as one of the Sukti Ratnani, Pratibadhnati Hishteya Pujya Puja Vyatikramaha. So if you have any doubts, we can discuss, or we can conclude today's meeting.
No doubts, Anna.
Okay.
No doubts.
Okay, so we'll conclude today's meeting. Gururev gatih gurumev bhaje gurunaiva sahasmi namo gurave na guroh paramam shishurasmi gurur matirasti gurau mama pahi guru. Ram ram ram.